set the meadows dancing.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Welcome, welcome everyone. Is the mic on? Yep, check. Something's not right. Let me see if it's plugged in. It's plugged in. We know it's working because it was working at our first service, so I'll just keep talking. Can you hear me? Oh. Perfect. Man, I was going to just start yelling, but now I don't need to. Well, welcome everyone to the Unitarian Universalist Church of Spokane, where we join together to create a nourishing, liberal religious home and to champion justice, diversity, and environmental stewardship in our wider world. Or as we say in short, to create community, find meaning, and work for justice. I want to begin, as always, by welcoming all that you bring with you to this space, all of your uniqueness, your unique beliefs, your background, your lifestyle, your experiences, all that helps make you who you are, including your differences, is welcome here this morning. And this includes those who hear us say this as part of our ritual each Sunday, as well as those who might be joining us for the first time. We're glad to have you, and it includes those of you who are joining us in person this morning, as well as the many of you who are streaming with us this morning, wherever you're at. It's always great to know you're with us as well. So welcome to one and all. I will also say Happy Easter. It's okay if I do that? It's all right? Yeah? Yeah? I never know how to deal with Easter because, you know, it's not one of the holidays that I really means much to me. But it means different things to different people. We have some kids here today. Does Easter mean something to you? What does it mean? What's going to happen today? Theo, what's going to happen on Easter today for you? What? Is it Easter? What is it coming? An Easter bunny's coming? Oh, yeah, that's a good one. Yeah? Now, you remember from last year. Good for you. Well, we'll see if the... Yes, Max, you got your hand up. What's happening? Candy. Yes, okay. So there's going to be an Easter egg hunt after the service, so...
I already knew that.
You knew that? All right. All right, at least it wasn't a spoiler alert. Anyway, so yeah, so Happy Easter to everybody who's excited about it today, and especially Easter bunnies and Easter eggs and all that stuff. So, April is also the month that we hold our annual generosity campaign, in which we ask our members and friends to consider pledging a certain amount to us for the coming year so that we can budget properly. And we'll want to have an idea of what kind of income we'll have this year, so that when we present our members with a budget to pass in June, it will be fairly accurate. So if you want to fill out a pledge form, there's some in the back. You can fill them out online. If you're going to sort of keep your pledge as it has been for the past year or a few years, or need to change it, please let us know that too. We would appreciate it so we get an accurate amount. Now, that's the boring part of my presentation on this morning. I really want to talk more personally about why Peggy and I contribute to this congregation. First of all, we love this congregation. We believe in it. You know, that's a big thing. But I was sort of came to the conclusion just yesterday. I was thinking about the formation of North American Unitarian Association, which is a new association, a budding association, to help support religious liberals throughout North America and elsewhere. And I realized that, you know, the kind of trauma and conflict this church went through back in 2019 when I gave away my controversial book, And the conflict, the internal conflict in our church, the external pressure on this congregation to force me out, coupled by COVID that shut us down and drove us apart, it was really, really a difficult time. And all of that ended up culminating in the recognition that we need this new organization. And I realize now that this is probably the best thing that could have happened to Unitarian Universalism. Unitarian Universalism was formed in 1961. At least that's when these two more ancient religions came together to form an association. And since then, we continue to lose our bearings. We continue to lose our connectedness to our roots and to our values that you're going to hear me talk about more in my sermon later on. Those liberal values that are the only values that have ever really carried humanity and societies forward. And we were losing those even before this conflict erupted. And now we have an opportunity to not only be part of an organization that reconnects with those values and promotes those values, but can truly use them to help transform the world in a way that it desperately needs right now. There's a much bigger mission that Unitarians have in this world. There's a reason we exist. There's a reason we come together. And it's because we believe in the values. We believe that every person is born with inherent worth and dignity. And therefore, we have to have systems in our society that uphold that dignity. And that means our societies have to be free. And we have to use reason. We have to be free to think for ourselves without having governments or social systems or anyone force us into conformity. And we have to, above all, be tolerant of our differences. That's what this is about. In this congregation, which has been here for 133 years, a radical history from day one, I won't go into right now. You've heard me talk about it before. Some of you have. Did something incredible, 3 years ago. You said, we're not getting rid of that guy. We're going to keep him. And we are going to remain a liberal congregation. Because we share those concerns and we share that commitment. And that is what has enabled NAUA to emerge. And that is what is going to help it to thrive and help liberal religion and liberalism itself to thrive again in our world. I mean, it's only been since the late 80s that the word liberal became a bad word. So bad that even liberals were afraid to call themselves liberals. Even though it's the only ideology that has ever proven to advance society when those values are in place. And this congregation has been an historic. From the time that it brought in its first minister in 1887, who was wanted dead or alive because of his stance, his wish to abolish slavery, to John Dietrich, the founder of humanism, and so many others along the way. This has been a radical institution with historic roots and historical meaning. And we are in a moment right now that may very well prove to be its most historical moment ever for the causes that we believe in, for the values that we share. So, I mean, I think this is why this congregation needs to be supported by all of us, by those who are members, those who are friends, those who stream with us, people from around the country and around the world who believe in what we're doing. We need your support. This congregation needs to thrive, and we thrive thanks to your generosity and your belief in what we're doing. And I thank you in advance for that support. So I have no great way to segue to greeting one another from that, but I do hope that you'll take a few moments to say hi to one another. Make some new friends today. There's some new faces, and there are some folks who are here today that haven't been with us for a little while, some who are returning from Florida and whatnot. So be sure and take a few moments to greet one another. So.
Unscheduled announcement. My wife's telling me I'm too loud. I've heard that before. I wanted to make you aware that a number of years now, I've been a subscriber of a podcast called Blocked and Reported. It's a really popular podcast that has a very large audience, and they recently did an episode about what's been going on for the past 2 or 3 years in the UUA, and the story heavily features our own Todd. So I just wanted to make you aware of it because I think it's a story that people will want to hear and will hear because, as I said, it has a really large audience. The way this podcast works is they only release certain episodes to paid subscribers, and this is a little bit unfortunately one of those episodes, but you can subscribe to a 7-day free trial, so you can listen to it without having to pay, but you'll have to, you know, go through that whole thing and then remember to cancel and blah blah blah. But I do recommend it, so please, if you feel so inclined, check out that episode. Again, the podcast, the first 15 minutes, they discuss adults who like to wear diapers, so you might fast forward 15 minutes through that if you're not interested in that topic. They're very sarcastic and irreverent, but they're also really good reporters, so I would recommend that episode to you. My wife is... Yeah? Do you think so?
Yeah.
Sure, yeah. I think we can do it. Okay, thanks.
Thank you, Shane. Thank you. Thank you, Shane. Yeah, that report was done by Katie Herzog, who is a really, I think, important voice on some of the issues that we're concerned about, and I was glad she reached out to me, and that we did an initial, you know, interview, and then she wrote me a lot of emails saying, I've got this question, one more question, and I would bombard her with documents, because I said, I know this is a lot, but I try to substantiate everything I say, so, you know. But anyway, I'm looking forward to hearing it. I'll try to hear it this week myself, so thank you, Shane. But let's move forward now with our chalice lighting. The chalice is the symbol of our unity and our solidarity, our openness and our inclusion, our community, and our individual uniqueness. May this small flame be our offering of warmth to those who are cold and alone, and a light to those in darkness. May it be a flame that ignites justice in our world and a beacon of hope to those in need. And may it reflect at least a spark of truth wherever truth has been lost, and cast a healthy shadow of doubt wherever it's been found.
For the opening words, several quotes from Roy Bennett, the author of Light in the Heart. Listen with curiosity, speak with honesty, act with integrity. The greatest problem with communication is that we don't listen to understand. We listen to reply. When we listen with curiosity, we don't listen with the intent to reply. We listen for what's behind the words. Instead of worrying about what you cannot control, shift your energy to what you can create.
Our first in-service hymn of the morning is We Sing of Golden Mornings, number 44. Please rise as you're willing and able.
Now kindle our candles of care for those who are most on our hearts and minds this morning. And we begin with a candle, as we have for some time now, on behalf of the people of Ukraine and that part of the world that are being most impacted by the senseless war and violence going on there. We also keep a candle alit for the people of Turkey and Syria, who are going to be recovering from devastating, tragic earthquakes there for years to come. Let's do take a moment of silence on behalf of others that you might be thinking of, and as always, you're welcome to name them aloud at this time if you'd like. those named aloud and those embraced in our silence, and all those who are suffering in our world at this hour, we hold in our community with compassion. And we now gratefully give and receive this morning's offering, which helps sustain this community and our mission to the larger world.
Doesn't that song just make you want to put on tap shoes?
Yeah.
Anyone else? All right. Well, I would love to welcome all of the children forward for our time for all ages. And while they're making their way up front, a couple of announcements. Your bulletin says that the family movie night begins at 6 o'clock, but it actually begins at 7. So 7 o'clock on Friday, we're watching Smallfoot. We've done a small-scale renovation to the young room and turned it into a movie and game room. So hope you can join us this Friday at 7 for our movie night. Directly after the second service, we'll be having our Easter egg hunt. Anybody excited about that?
Yeah.
You don't sound very excited. Is anybody excited about that?
Yeah.
Yeah, you can give a little whoop whoop. So this church not only comes together to defend liberalism, but also comes together to provide hundreds of Easter eggs filled with all sorts of treats. It is an at-your-own-risk Easter egg hunt, so parents, if you are concerned about any of the contents of the eggs, make sure that you're with your kids as they're opening and consuming. All right. And I'll be taking the children who are with me in Children's Chapel directly to the backyard towards the end of the second service. So instead of coming to the Thoreau room to pick up your kids, you'll meet them in the backyard where they'll be running for joy for eggs. All right, well.
Hyped up on sugar.
Yes, most likely. Well, today I have brought a special friend who hasn't been with us for a while. Hi, Bun Bun. All right, so it's a special day to bring Bun Bun back to church. Jude, it's a puppet. So it's a special day for Bun Bun to be here because it is Easter. And for many, many, many years, we have celebrated hope and renewal this time of year through symbolism about baby animals like bunnies and chicks. And Miss Deb has prepared a special song about chicks that she would like for us to teach Bun Bun this morning.
Yeah. This is about an Easter chick, and that Easter chick's name is Chicory Chick. Okay? And Chicory Chick likes to make up words. He got sick and tired of just saying chip, beep, all that kind of stuff. He wanted to do other things. So I'm going to teach you the chorus of the song. This is also a story song, so there'll be some story parts, and then we'll do the chorus, and then there'll be some more story, and we'll do the chorus. So, Maura, give me a, what is that, F sharp? Yeah. So here I'll just give you little chunks, and you too out there. Chicory chick, chala, chala. Chicory chick, chala, chala. Chickala roll me in a banana.
Shake-a-la, roll me in a bananica. Bollica, wallica, can't you see? Bollica, wallica, can't you see? Chicory chick is me. Chicory chick is me. Good, let's sing it twice. Here we go. Chicory chick, chala, chala. Check-a-la, roll me in a bananica. Bollica, wallica, can't you see? Chicory chick is me. Chicory chick, chala, chala. Check-a-la, roll me in a bananica. Bollica, wallica, can't you see? Chicory chick is me. Good, okay. So here's the start of the song. Once there lived a chicken who would say, chick, 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 all day. Soon that chick got sick and tired of saying, chick, chick. So one morning he started to say, here we go. Chickory chick, chala, chala, chakala, roll me in a bananica, bolica, wolica, can't you see? Chickory chick is me again. Chickory chick, chala, chala, chakala, roll me in a bananica, bolica, wolica, can't you see? Chickory chick is me. Every time you're sick and tired of just the same old thing, saying just the same old words all day.
Thank you so much, Evan. Thank you so much, kids. Bun Bun was singing it to me. He's still a little shy, doesn't want to sing out loud, but he was singing it to me and he was doing great. So thank you so much.
Yeah, thanks, Bun Bun.
No, only I can hear Bun Bun. I don't know.
Suspicious.
I know. It's good you're skeptical about it, Jude. All right, well, please join me in singing your children out to the Thoreau room, and remember, join them at the end of the service in the garden for our Easter egg hunt.
For this morning's meditation, a poem by Vera Nazarian, from the Perpetual Calendar of Inspiration. Listen to the trees as they sway in the wind. Their leaves are telling secrets. Their bark sings songs of olden days as it grows around the trunks. And their roots give names to all things. Their language has been lost, but not the gestures.
I have a one-sentence reading this morning. This was sent to me by one of our members, Terry Anderson, who lives in Alberta, Canada. And he said, I think this might be a good statement to go with what you're going to be talking about today. And I agree. It's a little short for a reading, but I'm going to read it anyway. Just one sentence, so pay attention. By the way, I don't know who this person is, and neither did Terry. Wendy Jade seems to be famous for writing this sentence. If you search their name on the internet, that's what you'll find. So here it is. An environment that is not safe to disagree is not an environment focused on growth. It's an environment focused on control.
Hello, darkness, my old friend. I've come to talk with you again. Because a vision softly creeping left its seeds while I was sleeping. And the vision that was planted in my brain still remains within the sound of silence. In restless dreams I walked alone, narrow streets of cobblestone, 'neath the halo of a street lamp. I turned my collar from the cold and damp, when my eyes were stabbed by the flash of a neon light that split the night and touched the sound of silence. And in the naked light I saw 10,000 people, maybe more, people talking without speaking, people hearing without listening, people writing songs that voices never share. No one dare disturb the sound of silence. Fool, I said, you do not know. Silence like a cancer grows. Hear my words that I might teach you. Take my arms that I might reach you. But my words like silent raindrops fell and echoed in the wells of silence. And the people bowed and prayed to the neon god they made. And the sign flashed out its warning in the words that it was forming. And the sign said the words of the prophet are written on the subway walls and tenement halls. Whispered in the sounds of silence.
Thank you, Deb. So Deb let me know when I came in that she's experiencing a little laryngitis. We wouldn't have known it at all, so thank you.
I was singing around some of it.
You were singing around some, and by the way, you can get so emotional when you sing a song that's meaningful to you. So you were working with both of those, and it was beautiful. Beautiful. Thank you. So liberalism and our liberal religion are both rooted in, as you often hear me say these days, the Enlightenment and its belief in the inherent worth and dignity of every person. And it is only through a deep commitment to this principle that some societies, including ours, would attempt to establish and maintain democracies in which every person has a voice in how they are to be governed. The continuation of these imperfect unions is dependent upon the strength of a society's guarantee of freedom, reason, and tolerance, the only means by which human dignity can be meaningfully respected. By freedom, we mean the freedom of speech and the freedom of participation. Every person has a right to express themselves without fear of prosecution, persecution, ostracization, demonization, termination, or any other legal or illegal ramifications for expressing their beliefs, no matter how contrary to the status quo. As importantly, freedom means that every person has an equal right to access the benefits of society without prejudice against them, regardless of what they look like, their gender, their color, their nationality, their sexuality, or any other arbitrary quality of their individual identity. By reason, we mean that our beliefs ought to be accepted and challenged by considering the empirical evidence and soundness of the thinking behind them, not by what the propagandists on faux news or BSNBC tell us with extreme bias, or according to the fantasies and fanaticisms of social media mobs. Liberalism's commitment to reason also means an individual must be trusted to think for oneself. In a free society, there can be no orthodoxy, no doctrine, no truth enforced upon us by any authority, church, state, or otherwise. Free thinking is a cornerstone of a free society. And by tolerance, we mean that every member of society is expected to live peacefully and respectfully toward those with whom they might differ and disagree. Merely tolerating each other may not be the best we can do. It may be the least that we can do in order to maintain respect for the inherent dignity of others. Tolerance is all that's required of us. See, even if we don't like someone, tolerance is all that's required of us. In a free society, there can be no orthodoxy, again, no doctrine. Therefore, we have to tolerate those with whom we differ. Tolerance is enough to acknowledge that every person deserves the same rights as us and ought to be free to go about their lives unaccosted by anyone. Tolerance is the linchpin that unifies us amidst our diversity, and it is diversity that makes a society strong. Today, however, the world's democracies, including our own, are becoming increasingly divided because too many of us don't respect those with whom we differ and disagree. Too many of us on both the right and the left are quick to disinvite, displatform, disfellowship, demonize, and otherwise disenfranchise our ideological opponents. According to Freedom House, our nation's oldest nonpartisan organization devoted to promoting and defending democracy around the world, there have been 16 years of consecutive decline in global freedom. This is so according to its 2022 report, because in countries with long-established democracies, internal forces have exploited the shortcomings in their systems, distorting national politics to promote hatred, violence, and unbridled power. Democratic societies require civility. And civility requires us to at least tolerate hearing ideas that we disagree with. Authoritarian societies, by contrast, forbid such freedom of expression and are quick to punish dissenters and heretics. From the medieval Catholic Inquisitions to the 20th century McCarthy hearings, we know this to be true. This is the fundamental point of George Orwell's dystopian horror novel, 1984, that for authoritarian societies to maintain power, they must above all control free flow of ideas by severely restricting freedom of speech. As one official from 1984's Ministry of Truth says, "We're destroying words. Scores of them, hundreds of them every day. We're cutting the language down to the bone. In the end, the whole notion of goodness and badness will be covered by only 6 words, in reality, only 1 word." Newspeak, as Orwell explains, was designed not to extend, but to diminish the range of thought. And this purpose was indirectly assisted by cutting the choice of words down to a minimum. This is frightening enough as a work of fiction, but to understand how close it has become to our reality is terrifying. And it is this fear of speaking that I want to turn our attention toward. To my knowledge, there is no word for fear of speaking, the fear of speaking that's become widespread in our modern democracies. Glossophobia refers merely to public speaking, which is akin to stage fright. I'm talking more about this insidious and growing fear of being punished or ostracized for unintentionally saying something that others find offensive or harmful. At best, offenders are called out and required to ritualistically confess their error and ask forgiveness. At worst, the unwitting offender experiences public humiliation, demonization, ostracization, and eventually having their character and career destroyed. Since there is no word for the kind of fear prompted by this sort of dread, I have made up my own, omiliaphobia, from the Greek words for speaking and fear. There is a version of this in which the words are separated, omiliaphobia, that refers to the fear of hearing speech. Probably like the kids when they come to church. But I'm talking, and that's a part of this too, right? Because you're afraid to hear speak if you're obsessed with it. But mainly I'm talking about this fear speaking anywhere for fear of being condemned in some way. And I'll propose that the more authoritarian a society is, the more omiliaphobic it becomes. Sometimes this fear of speaking is caused by authoritarians that use their power to directly control, intimidate, and punish those who say anything that they might disagree with. And we saw an almost unbelievable example of this in Tennessee just a couple days ago when a Republican majority expelled 2 Democratic lawmakers in the state legislature. The ousted lawmakers had participated in public protests calling upon the entire legislature to deal with gun violence, especially after another senseless, horrible shooting of children there. They did so, they say, after being repeatedly silenced by that majority, including having their microphones cut off while trying to discuss it during formal legislative sessions. This is a rare example of authoritarianism, at least in the U.S., and I hope the decision will be overturned and such dictatorial behavior doesn't become another new normal like the gun deaths these lawmakers are attempting to draw attention to have become. But again, it is more usual, even in the most authoritarian countries, for the citizens themselves to do most of the policing of themselves and others. This comes by using social forces like positive and negative reinforcement to develop strong patriotic feelings for one's country, including its government and even its top authority or dictator like Vladimir Putin in Russia, Xi Jinping in China, and Kim Jong-un in North Korea. In such societies, the police, military, and secret service may sometimes be used to arrest or assassinate their rare dissenters and critics, but for the most part, they too rely upon their indoctrinated citizens to censor themselves and their neighbors. And that's a whole lot cheaper than paying for an expensive police force or military to do it. And it helps the dictators have less of a risk of being overturned in a military coup if you have too strong and present a military. So the kind of draconian maneuvers like we saw in Tennessee this week and in Texas, where an anti-abortion activist and federal judge went against all precedent when banning an FDA-approved abortion medicine, these are rare in democracy. Self-censoring, however, is common even in the freest of societies. This is so because individual citizens are more loyal to their party or their identity group or their own beliefs than they are to anything that their party or group stands for. They care more about their side winning and staying on top than they do about the liberal values that free societies are founded upon and thrive upon. To hell with democracy, ethics, integrity. To hell with freedom, reason, and tolerance. To hell with inherent worth and dignity. We win. The degradation of liberal values and democracies isn't due to an authoritarian big brother, as it is in authoritarian countries, as George Orwell imagined it, but to their disregard by a majority of ordinary citizens, more akin to Ray Bradbury's dystopian novel, Fahrenheit 451. In his story, firemen are not used to put out fires, but to start them in order to burn books. But book burning and ultimately the banning of free speech it causes or leads to didn't come from the government down, Bradbury writes. There was no dictum, no declaration, no censorship to start with, no. Technology, mass exploitation, and minority pressure carried the trick. Considering Fahrenheit 451 was written in 1954, Bradbury's novel was incredibly foretelling of what has become true for us today. By the way, that was only 3 years after 1984. In his story, society began to fracture due to the emergence of too many special interest groups that made it impossible for anyone to ever say anything meaningful without offending somebody. Don't step on the toes of dog lovers, cat lovers, doctors, lawyers, merchants, chiefs, Mormons, Baptists, Unitarians, second generation Chinese, Swedes, Italians, Germans, Texans, Brooklynites, Irishmen, people from Oregon or Mexico, Bradbury writes. And given what's happening to our own liberal religion today, it's remarkable that he included way back then Unitarians in his list of intolerant special interest groups. It was this fear of saying something offensive to others, omiliaphobia, that led to the destruction of free speech in Fahrenheit 451. The bigger your market, Bradbury writes, the less you handle controversy. Remember that. All the minor minorities with their navels to be kept clean, authors full of evil thoughts, lock up your typewriters. The only publications to survive the literary purge were those that said nothing. Comic books and pornography. In the end, he says, firemen, the official book burners, were rarely necessary. The public itself stopped reading of its own accord. The point here is that a society can become no less authoritarian, perhaps even more so, when it's instigated by the masses as by a government or dictator. In addition to the splintering of society into what we now call identity groups, Bradbury says technology, mass exploitation, and minority pressure are responsible. And today, social media often takes the place of courts when it comes to trying, convicting, and punishing those deemed to have offended a particular identity group. Likewise, the mass exploitation, he predicted, isn't conducted by state-controlled media, as it is in Russia, for example, but by less than a dozen corporations, really less than half a dozen corporations, that use the once free press to promote their own political agendas by demonizing their ideological opponents and using propaganda, not news, to influence the masses and to turn us against each other. And by minority pressure, Bradbury wasn't referring to, as we do today, racial minorities, but to identity groups, be it based on race, nationality, politics, religion, gun rights, dog lovers, cat lovers, or something else. When associating more closely with our identity groups than the liberal values that can unite us, we end up following the most extreme fringe in order to stay united, which is what's happened to the Republican Party. Or we fracture into numerous tribes that refuse to play if our team doesn't get its way, making it impossible for us to gain or sustain the collective political power necessary for us to make any positive changes. All of this is exacerbated by the omiliaphobia that has become epidemic in the world, especially in North America. These social forces, technology, mass media, and tribalism, have made us afraid to genuinely talk to each other. Talk about gun control, and you get your microphone turned off. Protest gun violence, and you get expelled from a democratically elected position. Write a book or article that some group dislikes and get condemned on social media and fired from your job. Last year, while attending the Heterodox Academy's conference in Denver, I heard a brilliant professor of medieval history give a captivating lecture comparing the Catholic Inquisitions to today's so-called cancel culture. Her presentation was so polished, I assume that she had to have given it many times before. So I asked, is this something that you've shared with your students? She responded with a short, ha, as if I must be kidding, and so did every other academic in the room. Ha. That's an example of omiliaphobia. College professors afraid to discuss certain matters with their students, including a history professor who has a prescient example of how history directly ties into what's going on today. Afraid to talk about it. Ha, you must be joking. Teach our students controversial history? Ha. I recently heard a couple of examples that illustrate the sort of experiences that lead to omiliaphobia in our own everyday lives, this fear of speaking. In one case, a woman was in a staff lunchroom when others began complimenting her on her new shoes. A seemingly common and innocuous conversation, would you agree? Then a fellow interrupted to say that talking about new shoes was a trigger for him because he was made fun of as a child for having big feet. After others coddled him for a bit, the conversation shut down, as should be expected, where participants can't even talk about their shoes without fear of hurting someone's feelings. Another instance involved a fellow who was summoned to his boss's office and told he would have to take racial sensitivity training because another employee complained that he'd said something racist. The employee overheard the man, who was not a racist, say to another employee that he felt the neighborhood was going downhill because of rising crime and litter. He wasn't given the name of the complainant or an opportunity to explain his side of the matter, yet keeping his job was conditioned on his successful completion of the sensitivity training. And just last month, an article in The Guardian reported the books written by beloved children's author Roald Dahl, including titles like James and the Giant Peach, Charlie and the Chocolate Factory, and The Witches, are being redacted by their current publisher to remove harmful language. Instead of fat, Augustus Goop is now called enormous. That's no fat there. That's enormous. Because that's so much better. Mrs. Twit is no longer ugly and beastly. She's just beastly. The problem is that the purification of language never stops. Not long after a word is replaced with something considered more suitable, it too becomes taboo. It never stops. It's meaningless puritanism. Some of you may have seen the Elimination of Harmful Language Initiative, recently published by Stanford University's IT department. In addition to replacing terms like blind study with masked study, walk-in with drop-in, tribe with friends, white paper with position paper, you guys with folks, and prostitute with person who engages in sex work, you can laugh at these. It's okay. The list now considers the word trigger to be a trigger, explaining that the phrase can cause stress about what's to follow. So instead of giving trigger warnings, we must now use the term content note. But what's to prevent this term from also making someone anxious about what's to follow? Oh God, a content note. And what if masked study reminds someone of having been robbed by a masked bandit? And why does engaging in sex work sound better than prostitution? I don't. You might be interested to know that University of Washington's IT department recently published a similar list of taboo words. Male and female connectors must now be called pin and receptacle. And this is not a comedy routine, I'm telling you. Brown bag must be called lunch and learn. And the peanut gallery must be called the upper balcony or cheap seats. Right? So, what about people with peanut allergies or those who are too poor to afford better seats? Maybe we should call them seats for the economically challenged persons. More importantly, this linguicidal obsession isn't changing the world one iota at a time, let alone one word at a time. And I shudder to think internet technicians have become our ministry of truth, dedicated to cutting our choice of words down to a minimum. When examples like these arise, people around my age, maybe a little younger or older, are shocked, even if not a little amused. But imagine growing up in a linguicidal culture in which there is almost always somebody eager to pounce on any little thing that can be misconstrued as offensive. Can there be any wonder that anxiety rates are on the rise among young people? Beginning in 2013, when cancel culture really became into its heyday on college campuses, students with anxiety increased to a historic high of 45% and was over 50% by 2016. This is the generation that was first conditioned to be afraid of speaking because saying anything might get one publicly shamed or ostracized. As Lukianoff and Haight say in their book, Coddling of the American Mind, reports from around the country are remarkably similar. Students at many colleges today are walking on eggshells, afraid of saying the wrong thing, liking the wrong post, or coming to the defense of someone whom they know to be innocent out of fear that they themselves might be called out by a mob on social media. That's omiliaphobia. Afraid to speak. Of course they're anxious. Today, even as we watch in despair as right-wing conservatives are dismantling democratic institutions before our very eyes, extremists on the left are undermining the very values that define what a democracy is supposed to be about. They think they're making the world more just, but they are just making the rest of us more anxious in a world that already has enough to legitimately worry about. But there is a solution to all of these problems. The only solution that has ever worked, the recognition that every person has inherent worth and dignity no matter what language they speak or what words they use. And this is why our liberal religion and liberalism itself must not only survive, but be reinvigorated to levels not seen since the Enlightenment. This is what this moment in history demands of us. Freedom, reason, tolerance, these are the only principles that can unite humanity and unite the world and unite Republicans and unite Democrats. And this is the purpose of NAUA, of North American Unitarian Association, of the Unitarian Universalist Church of Spokane, of Unitarianism, to enable our liberal religion to emerge from the shadows of ridicule and uselessness and obscurity to become a vital force for good in the world. It is why in the near future, we will be joined by individuals and congregations who have been longing for a truly liberal association that they can be proud to be part of. And it is why others who have never heard of Unitarianism before will rush to join us. Because we have reconnected with our historic roots and its transformative values. And together we will inspire humanity itself to rise to the heights of its fullest potential, ushering in an age of peace and justice and progress unlike anything the world has ever seen. May it be so. Thank you.
We're going to close the day with what the world needs now is love. So please stand as you're willing and able to sing along with me.
His love, sweet love, no, not just for some, but for everyone. Lord, we don't need another mountain. There are mountains and hillsides enough to climb.
The benediction, the words of St. Joan Chittister, Benedictine nun and advocate for peace and human rights. When fear of the unknown strangles the heart, one tiny act of courage can bring hope alive. Frail and sputtering, perhaps, but there to be grasped in the mist. Amen, blessed be, salam aleikum, and shalom.
Sure.